You're standing in front of a new project, and someone just said, use Modbus TCP, it's cheaper, and they're both Ethernet anyway. But here's what they didn't tell you. That decision could either save your project or absolutely sink it. And the difference isn't what most people think. Hey everyone, Alana here. After years of watching engineers make this choice, I've seen million-dollar mistakes that could have been avoided with the right understanding. Let's understand what we're really looking at. Both of these protocols run on standard Ethernet. That's true. But saying they're the same because of that is like saying a bicycle and a motorbike are the same because they both get you from point A to point B. To really understand the differences, we need to go back to where each came from. Modbus was born in 1979. Modbus was designed for simple serial communication between a few devices in an isolated factory environment. It was brilliant for its time, elegant, simple, and it worked. When Ethernet came along, someone said, let's just wrap our existing Modbus messages in TCP packets and call it Modbus TCP. Ethernet IP, on the other hand, was born in the late 90s, when we already understood networks and complex automation. It wasn't an adaptation. It was purpose-built for modern industrial networks. This origin story explains everything else we're going to discuss today. Every strength and weakness traces back to these fundamental design philosophies. Let's start with how these protocols actually communicate, because this is where the rubber meets the road in real applications. Modbus TCP uses what we call a client-server model, though you might know it by its old name, master-slave. The concept is simple. One device asks, another device answers, always. This works fine for small systems, or when you're just monitoring data that doesn't change quickly. But watch what happens when you scale up. With 50 devices, and if you need real-time control, forget about it. By the time you've polled all 50 devices, your first reading is ancient history. Ethernet IP solves this with a completely different approach. For configuration and diagnostics, it uses explicit messaging. That's similar to Modbus TCP's client-server model. But for real-time I/O data, it switches to something called implicit messaging with a producer-consumer model. Instead of calling each zone operator, you set up a group chat. Each zone operator posts their temperature once, and everyone who needs to know gets it simultaneously. One message, multiple consumers. But here's the clever part. Ethernet IP also uses UDP instead of TCP for this real-time data. TCP is like registered mail. It guarantees delivery, but takes time for all the handshakes and confirmations. UDP is like broadcasting on a radio. Fast, efficient, but you don't wait around for confirmations. For real-time control, you'd rather get the latest data quickly than wait for confirmation that old data arrived safely. This architectural difference is why Ethernet IP can handle high-speed, synchronized control tasks that would bring Modbus TCP to its knees. Now let's talk about how each protocol thinks about data, because this affects everything from programming to troubleshooting. Modbus TCP sees the world as four big filing cabinets: coils for on-off outputs, discrete inputs for on-off sensors, input registers for measurement data, and holding registers for set points and configuration. That's it. Simple, straightforward, and completely generic. The protocol has no idea what's actually in those registers. Register 4001 could be motor speed, temperature, pressure. Modbus doesn't know and doesn't care. That's up to your application software to figure out. This simplicity is both a strength and a weakness. It's a strength because any device can talk to any other device using the same basic commands. It's a weakness because every integration requires custom programming to interpret what those raw numbers actually mean. Ethernet IP takes a completely different approach with something called the Common Industrial Protocol Object Model. Instead of generic registers, it organizes data into objects that represent real-world things. An analog input object doesn't just give you a number. It gives you the engineering units, scaling information, alarm limits, and even diagnostic information about the sensor health. A motor object includes speed, torque, current, fault status, and operating hours all organized together. This means devices are self-describing. When you connect a new Ethernet IP device, your system can automatically discover what it is, what data it provides, and how to interpret that data. No more guessing what register 41157 means. The device tells you its inlet pressure in PSI with a range of 0-300. All right, let's have the conversation that too many people want to avoid, cybersecurity. This is where the 1979 origins of Modbus TCP become a serious liability. Traditional Modbus TCP has zero built-in security. None. It was designed for isolated networks where the biggest threat was someone tripping over a cable. No passwords, no encryption, no authentication, everything runs in plain text. If I'm on your network and you're using standard Modbus TCP, I can see every command, every set point, and every measurement. I can turn your equipment on and off, change your recipes, and modify your safety limits. And you won't even know I was there until something breaks. Now here's what's important. The Modbus organization did recognize this problem and published an official Modbus TCP security specification in 2018. This adds TLS encryption on top of standard Modbus TCP, providing authentication, data encryption, and integrity checking. It's sometimes called Modbus TCP TLS, but adoption has been extremely limited. Most Modbus TCP implementations still run wide open, just like they did in 1979. The security extension exists, but it requires both devices to support it, adds complexity, and many legacy devices simply can't handle the processing overhead. So while Modbus TCP security exists on paper, in practice you're still usually building external security measures around standard Modbus TCP devices. Industrial firewalls, VPNs, network segmentation, and air gaps, all external solutions that add cost, complexity, and maintenance overhead. Ethernet IP took a different approach by developing CIP security as an extension. Now, here's something important. CIP security isn't automatically enabled on every Ethernet IP system. I have worked on numerous Ethernet IP networks that operate in an open fashion, similar to Modbus TCP. When CIP security is implemented, it provides what security professionals call defense in depth. Device authentication using digital certificates, only trusted devices can join the network. Data encryption using the same TLS protocols that protect your online banking. Message integrity checking. If someone tries to modify a command in transit, it gets rejected. And user authentication with role-based access control. Different users can have different permission levels. Despite advancements in industrial communication, standard Ethernet IP devices continue to necessitate a multi-layered approach to security. This is primarily due to their inherent design, which often prioritizes operational efficiency and real-time control over robust built-in cybersecurity features. Now let's talk about the capabilities that really set Ethernet IP apart, the integrated services that Modbus TCP simply cannot provide. Remember, Ethernet IP isn't just a communication protocol, it's a complete automation ecosystem. Let me walk you through some game-changing capabilities. First up, CIP safety. This is certified functional safety communication up to SIL3. That's the highest level for most industrial applications. You can run safety-rated devices and standard control devices on the same network. Your emergency stops, light curtains, and safety PLCs can communicate over the same Ethernet cable as your standard I/O and drives. Instead of separate hardwired safety circuits for every device, you run one Ethernet cable and configure safety zones and software. But more importantly, you get diagnostics on your safety system. You can see which safety device tripped and why, instead of just getting a generic safety fault alarm. Next, CIP motion. This is synchronized high-performance motion control over standard Ethernet. I've seen systems coordinate 100 servo axes with 1 millisecond update rates, electronic line shafting, synchronized conveyor systems, coordinated robotic cells, all running over the same network as your HMI and standard I/O. The key is CIP sync. That's precision time synchronization based on IEEE 1588. Every device on the network shares the same clock, accurate to within 100 nanoseconds. That's what makes true synchronization possible. With Modbus TCP, if you need motion control, you're adding a separate motion network, separate cables, separate programming, separate troubleshooting. With Ethernet, IP, it's all integrated. Let's tackle the cost question, because this is where I see the most confusion and frankly the most bad decisions. Yes, Modbus TCP devices cost less upfront. The protocol is free, the hardware requirements are minimal, and integration seems straightforward. But let me walk you through the hidden costs that nobody talks about in the initial budget meeting. Security infrastructure, industrial firewalls, managed switches with VLAN capability, VPN systems for remote access. I've seen security retrofits cost more than the original control system. Engineering time. Every Modbus TCP integration requires custom work to map those generic registers to meaningful data. Multiply that by dozens or hundreds of devices, and you're talking serious engineering hours. Scalability limitations. When your Modbus TCP network starts slowing down because you've added too many devices, you need additional controllers or network segments. More hardware, more complexity, more maintenance. Ethernet IP has higher upfront costs, devices are more expensive, there are licensing fees, and the initial setup is more complex. But you're buying an integrated platform. The device integration is standardized. The performance is designed for scalability. The advanced features like safety and motion don't require separate networks. When you add it all up over the life cycle, the total cost of ownership often favors Ethernet IP, especially for larger, more complex systems. All right, let's bring this all together with a practical decision framework you can use on your next project. First, will this system ever connect to anything beyond an isolated network? If yes, and security matters at all, Ethernet IP gives you proven, native security through CIP security. While Modbus TCP security with TLS exists on paper, it's rarely implemented in practice. Second, do you need real-time control or high-speed coordination? If you're doing closed-loop control with update times faster than 100 milliseconds, or if you need synchronized motion, Ethernet IP is your only practical choice. Third, what's your scale? If you're looking at more than 20, 30 devices, or if the system might grow significantly, Ethernet IP's scalability advantages become compelling. Fourth, do you need integrated safety or motion control? If yes, Ethernet IP with CIP safety and CIP motion will save you money and complexity compared to separate networks. Finally, what's your vendor ecosystem? If you're primarily using North American automation vendors, Ethernet IP will give you the best integration. If you need maximum flexibility with international or specialty vendors, Modbus TCP's universal compatibility is valuable. Here's my bottom line. Both protocols have earned their place in industrial automation, but they're tools for fundamentally different jobs. Choose Modbus TCP for simple data acquisition, standalone machines, legacy system integration, or when you need maximum vendor flexibility with minimal upfront investment. Choose Ethernet IP for connected systems, real-time control, large-scale networks, integrated safety or motion, or any application where you might need native cybersecurity capabilities in the future. But here's the most important advice I can give you. Don't make this decision based solely on initial device costs. Think about where your system needs to be in 10 years, not just where it is today. The biggest mistakes I've seen happen when someone chooses the cheaper option up front, then discovers they need capabilities that protocol simply cannot provide. What's your experience with these protocols? Have you run into any of these limitations in your own projects? Drop a comment and share your story. Your experience might help another person avoid a costly mistake. If this deep dive helped clarify the decision for you, give it a thumbs up and subscribe for more practical control insights. Thanks for watching.